The Lord possessed me in the beginning of his way, before his works of old. I was set up from everlasting, from the beginning, or ever the earth was. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no fountains abounding with water. Before the mountains were settled, before the hills was I brought forth. While as yet he had not made the earth, nor the fields, nor the highest part of the dust of the world. When he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he set a compass upon the face of the depth. When he established the clouds above. When he strengthened the fountains of the deep. When he gave to the sea his decree, that the waters should not pass his commandment. When he appointed the foundations of the earth. Then I was by him, as one brought up with him, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him. Proverbs chapter 8, verses 22 through 30. Now today I want to talk about the preexistence of Christ. The preexistence of Christ is the existence which he had before assuming a human nature, okay? Before he became flesh, before the man Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary. The doctrine of the preexistence of Christ is an essential doctrine of the Christian faith. If Christ did not have any existence before his incarnation, before he became flesh, before he assumed a human nature, then he could not be deity. If Christ is not divine, then there is no Trinity. The preexistence of Christ standing alone may not necessarily affirm Christ's deity, but if Christ is divine, which is true, then his preexistence is implied from his deity. God is eternal, with no beginning, and therefore, if Christ is divine, then he must have no beginning as well. So, I want to make note here that the preexistence of Christ and what's in the balance with this doctrine and why it's so important, the things that I just said and went over. So we got the pre-existence of Christ, the fact that there was an existence of Christ before he became flesh, okay? And this is connected to, let's see where I'm at on the board here, okay? Okay. This is connected to the eternity of Christ, the fact that Christ is eternal. The fact that Christ is eternal is connected to his deity, the fact that Christ is God in the flesh, okay, that Jesus Christ was God in the flesh. And that, the fact that Jesus Christ is God, is connected to the Trinity. Okay, you know, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, these three are one. So you can see how all these things are interwoven and how important the preexistence of Christ is, because if you don't have one of these, then the others will fall. Okay. So I want you to understand how these are all connected. Basically, if somebody denies the preexistence of Christ, they're denying that Christ is eternal, they're denying that he is God, they're denying the Trinity. So there's a lot at stake there. Now, some completely deny and reject any preexistence of Christ. Others affirm the preexistence of Christ, but differentiate between the nature of this preexistence. Okay? So there are those who completely reject the preexistence of Christ. You know, obviously atheists, people who just reject God as a whole, you know, they'll just say that Jesus was a person who existed, he was just a revolutionary, you know, just a good person or whatever, and, you know, there's no God, there's no afterlife or whatever. Well, of course, that's false, and the Bible completely rejects that. But, you know, then there's some who would even be as ridiculous to say that the person Jesus Christ, you know, never even existed in history or whatever, which, you know, there's plenty of proof to show that he did. But, as I said, then there are others who will say, yeah, Christ did pre-exist before the incarnation, but they will have a different view of than the nature of that pre-existence. And so just for some examples, some believe an idealist view in which Christ only pre-existed in the sense that he existed in the mind of God, like God's foreknowledge, basically. Okay, and you know, if that's the case, then you know everybody else, you know, all humans pre-existed as well because God foreknew all of us individually. Okay, so obviously, when we're talking about the pre-existence of Christ, we're not talking about God's foreknowledge. Okay. But that's what some people believe, but Scripture refutes that. Now, Jehovah's Witnesses believe and teach that Christ existed before the incarnation, but as a created being, an archangel. And so there's so much proof in the Bible that, you know, that Christ is God. And, you know, so much proof of the pre-existence that if they deny Christ's deity, if people deny that Christ is God, like the Jehovah's Witnesses here, they'll say that, you know, he was an archangel previously, he was a created being, then they have to give him some kind of higher status, like, you know, say that he was the highest of all created beings because, you know, there's reverence given to him, you know, like only that God would receive. So, you know, it's very, very strange. I guess that in the early days of Christianity, you know, in the early church, I could say, there were these people called Arians. I guess, I don't know, some guy with his last name Arian or something. I don't know every detail about it. But I guess they pretty much taught the same thing, that there was a time when Christ didn't exist, and, you know, that he was a created being. And so Jehovah's Witnesses are kind of like the modern-day Arians. Anyways, so Jehovah's Witnesses, they say, yes, Christ did pre-exist, but he did pre-exist the incarnation, but there was a time when he didn't exist, and he's a created being, and they say that he was an angel, the archangel Michael, I guess. Mormons believe in the pre-existence of Christ, but as another God, apart from the Father. So I don't know exactly the details about the Mormon beliefs, but I do know that they believe in multiple gods, and they believe that when it says that Jesus was the Son of God, they think that, you know, he's a separate being. He's like another God, and the Father's a God, and Jesus is another God, as far as what I understand. Now, Seventh-day Adventists, this is pretty interesting. I guess that Seventh-day Adventists, or at least this is in some of their writing, there might be some who disagree, but they deny that Christ pre-existed as the begotten Son of God. So they teach that he was unbegotten like the Father in his pre-existence. So instead of referring to him as the Son of God prior to the incarnation, they refer to him as the second person in the Godhead. According to their theology, there was basically no distinctions between the persons and the Godhead before the incarnation. And so they believe that he became the Son of God when he became incarnate. And that's what's called incarnational sonship. And I guess that Walter Martin and John MacArthur used to believe that. And so they deny the eternal generation and the eternal sonship of Christ, and the eternal fatherhood of the Father. So that's pretty interesting. So Seventh-day Adventists, they do believe that Christ pre-existed, but not as the Son of God, only as the second person in the Trinity, and that he was unbegotten like the Father. And so there's like no distinctions between the Father and the Son there. And so, you know, it's not a biblical teaching of the Trinity. And I think that it would also imply that Jesus has changed, that Jesus Christ is not immutable, I would think. But I don't know all the details about that. But I do know that what they believe is wrong. So some people think that any preexistence of Christ would make him less human, and rejecting it by doing so, denying his deity. So they do not understand how Christ can be fully divine and fully human. But regardless of our ability to comprehend such a thought, it's what the Bible teaches, and we must stand on these truths. It is important that we believe and understand not only that Christ did have a preexistence or an existence before his incarnation, but also that we believe and understand the nature of that very existence. And so I talked about these people, these Arians in the early church age, and I guess it was a big deal. And so these people got together in this council of Nicaea, this first council, and they made a creed or something to refute these heresies. And they coined this phrase, there never was a time when he was not. Because the Arians would say there was a time when he was not, you know, when Christ didn't exist. So the first council of Nicaea, they came up with this phrase, there was never a time when he was not, okay? Or there never was when he was not. Christ is eternal. He had no beginning. The true nature of the preexistence of Christ is an eternal existence. Before the creation of all things, as the second person of the Trinity, a divine person, the eternal Word, the Son of God, distinct from the Father and the Holy Spirit, yet equal with God, for he was God. Okay. Now, so I mentioned there's this doctrine called the eternal generation. Okay, and tied to his preexistence. And there's the eternal sonship. Said that what some people believe, like the Seventh-day Adventists and John MacArthur used to believe, is that the second person of the Trinity didn't become the Son of God until he became incarnate. But the Bible teaches otherwise. The Bible teaches that he's always been the Son. Okay, there was never a time when Christ wasn't the Son of God. And eternal generation means that Christ was always begotten, eternally begotten. There was never a time when Christ was unbegotten. Okay, this is a distinction between the Father and the Son. And you know, that's why it's good when we describe the Trinity, that we don't say that there are three separate beings or three separate persons. And three separate beings would be polytheism. It would be more than one God. But if we say, you know, there's three separate persons in one being, then that's not what the Bible teaches. They're not separate. They're distinct. Okay, and they're united. Jesus said, "I and my Father are one." And so that means unity, not separation. They're united, but they're distinct. And these are some of those distinctions, is that the second person is the Son. He's begotten of the Father since always. So that's connected to this too. And I want to go into detail into more of all these. I think these would be some good little studies to do, the eternal generation, to show that Christ was always begotten. The eternal sonship, which also kind of has to do with, you know, the eternal Father, and also the fact that the Father was unbegotten. And I guess that there's a doctrine, too, called the eternal procession of the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit has always proceeded from the Father. So that makes the Holy Spirit distinct as a person in the Trinity as well. And so I would like to cover these in better studies individually, the eternal generation, the eternal sonship, and, you know, the deity of Christ. I want to go over that more, and, of course, the Trinity. And so all these things tie in together. And the eternity of Christ and the preexistence of Christ pretty much go hand in hand, very, very closely related. So, you know, those are pretty much inseparable. And really, the preexistence of Christ and the eternity of Christ are pretty much, and the deity of Christ are pretty much inseparable, too. But, you know, as I've shown, there are some who will try to say that he did preexist, but he isn't deity. And so you kind of got to go into the more of the specifics about that. And so, and also, let's see, I'll try to get room here. So, also said that, this identity, the identity of Christ, is second person, the Word, the eternal Word, you know, the Son of God, eternal Word, the Son of God, the second person, I guess Christ. So I said there's some different names with the identity of Christ before his incarnation. You know, we'd say he's the second person of the Trinity. He's the eternal Word. You know, in the Gospel of John, it talks about how the Word became flesh. You know, the Word was in the beginning. The Word was with God. The Word was God. Speaking of Christ, okay, he is the eternal Word. Since all eternity, he's always been the Son of God. Okay, he was the Son of God before the incarnation. He's always been Christ, and so he's always been divine. That's why I said that there is one Christ, is one divine person. Okay, his person is divine, not a human person. Okay, he became flesh, but he's a divine person. So there was a time when the man Jesus didn't exist, okay, before the man Jesus was born. But the man Jesus was the incarnate Son of God who always existed. So I'm going to move this. And I'm going to be going over proof texts that will prove the preexistence of Christ, the eternity of Christ, you know, which will also prove the deity of Christ. And so that kind of helps us to refute some of those false views without going into detail of those false views and stuff, you know, which I could do for other studies. But this is going to help us a lot anyways, just to see these positive proof texts. Before I get into these evidences, I want to talk about how Scripture speaks of Christ as the only begotten Son, or as the firstborn, or the first begotten. And I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on this, but just to clarify things, because some people will try to, who deny the preexistence, or deny, you know, the eternal sonship or the eternal generation, they'll look at these verses when Jesus is spoken of as the only begotten or the firstborn or the first begotten, and they'll try to say, well, see, he didn't exist, you know, before then, because this is, you know, it says that he was the firstborn, so that must mean that there was a time when he didn't exist, or whatever. So we got to understand that's false, and because when I give these evidences, these proof texts, you'll see that that's false. They'll refute that. But, okay, when Christ is spoken of as begotten, there is something more in the meaning of begotten than is commonly understood of birth. When we think of birth, we think of that as the beginning of all personal existence for the individual. In light of all the plain teachings of the Scripture concerning an existence prior to Bethlehem for the Christ with a real individual personality, we must find further meaning. Okay. And Christ was not begotten in time, but eternity, in eternity. So there was never a time when Christ wasn't begotten. Okay. Christ has always been begotten. He's always been. And so, and that's hard for us to wrap our minds around. Okay. We can't really understand, well, what does it mean that he was begotten if, you know, he's always been begotten of the Father, you know, in eternity? How can we understand that? How can we explain that? How can we describe that? You know, we can't to its fullest, but it's what the Bible teaches, and that's what we have to go by. Okay. It's amazing. So Christ was not begotten in time, but in eternity. He's eternally begotten. This is the eternal generation of Christ. And so this term, the only begotten, it's never applied by John to any but Jesus Christ. It's applied to him five times, by him five times to the Savior. I guess John 1:14, John 1:18, John 3:16, John 3:18, 1 John 4:9. It means literally an only child. This, as an only child, is especially dear to a parent. It means one that is especially beloved. Compare Genesis chapter 2, verse 2, Genesis 22, verse 2, Genesis 22, verse 12, Genesis 22, verse 16, Jeremiah 6, 26, Zechariah 12, 10. On both of these accounts, it is bestowed to the Savior. Now, as he was eminently the Son of God, sustaining a special relation to him in his divine nature, exalted above all human beings and angels, and thus worthy to be called by way of eminence his only Son. Saints are called his sons or children because they are born of his Spirit or are like him, but the Lord Jesus is exalted far above all and deserves eminently to be called his only begotten Son. And he was especially dear to God, and therefore this appellation implying tender affection is bestowed upon him. Okay, so there's times when Scripture talks of Christ as being first begotten in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 6. And again, when he bringeth in the first begotten into the world, he saith, and let all the angels of God worship him. Romans chapter 8, verse 29 says, Jesus is the firstborn among many brethren. Romans chapter 8, verse 29 says, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. That he might be the firstborn among many brethren, the firstborn, the Son by nature, his many brethren, sons by adoption. He in the humanity of the only begotten of the Father, bearing our sins on the accursed tree, they and that of mere men ready to perish by reason of sin, but redeemed by his blood from condemnation and wrath and transformed into his likeness. So Christ is the firstborn, only begotten Son of God by nature. Okay. And so we as saints, believers in Christ, the redeemed, the regenerated, born again Christians, we are sons and daughters of God by regeneration and adoption, okay, not by nature like Christ. Says that Christ is the firstborn of every creature in Colossians chapter 1, verse 15, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. Begotten, it means he was begotten before all creation. We continue to read on in Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 and 17. It says, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist. And obviously that kind of, that speaks of the preexistence of Christ. You know, probably all of these do, I guess, in a way, but I'll go over that one more specifically later on. But the firstborn of every creature, basically that he existed before every creature, that he was begotten before all creation. So this is a verse that can be used to teach the eternal generation of Christ. Then we got the firstborn from the dead. Colossians chapter 1, verse 18, and he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. Which is similar to Revelation chapter 1, verse 5, which says, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Now I want to mention that some interpreters rendering firstborn when talking about the firstborn or first begotten of the dead or from the dead find in the phrase the metaphor of death as the womb which bare him, comparing Colossians chapter 1 verse 18 with Acts chapter 13 verse 33, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee, to oppose Christ's natural and eternal sonship. But very inconsequently and absurdly, for number one, Christ was properly the Son of God before his resurrection from the dead. He did not receive that relation by it, as other texts clearly prove. Psalm chapter 2, verse 7, Proverbs chapter 30, verse 4, Micah chapter 5, verse 2, John chapter 1, verse 1, and chapter 17, verse 5. And number two, if his resurrection had been a begetting of him, then would he have begotten himself, so been father and son to himself, because he raised himself. So that doesn't work. So there are some who say that, you know, Christ didn't become the Son of God until he was born as a man. And then there are some who will say that, you know, he became the Son of God when he was resurrected. That's when he was begotten or whatever. So no, you know, this is a phrase, the first begotten from the dead, or the firstborn, that there's a lot of different interpretations on it. And, you know, I had sleepless nights over reading these scriptures of him being the firstborn of every creature and the first begotten. And, you know, there's I made a video before, and it's a popular teaching that whenever it talks about Jesus Christ being the firstborn, that it simply means that he's preeminent. It just means he's above all things, he's before all things. And you can kind of have scripture to back that teaching up, because you can see that in the Old Testament where it's used that way, kind of as like a metaphor. But I don't necessarily think now that that might be, it might not be wholly true. Now, of course, Christ is preeminent. Okay, he is before all things. All things are his. So Christ is preeminent. Scripture clearly teaches that. That doesn't necessarily mean that that's what it means when it says that he's the first begotten of every creature, or the firstborn of the dead. I said that, you know, when it says he's the firstborn of every creature, that it means that, you know, he was existent before then. He was before all creation, eternally generated, eternally begotten. Sorry, kind of losing it here. Anyways, I had sleepless nights over this. What does it mean that he was the firstborn from the dead? And I said that, you know, it doesn't mean that he was somehow begotten, you know, in the resurrection. But I do think that it does have to speak of the resurrection, how Christ is the resurrection, and he kind of led the way. It wouldn't be possible. The resurrection wouldn't be possible without his resurrection. And I think that's kind of what it means. There's different views that have been put forth. And, you know, there could be a handful of interpretations that could be acceptable, whether they're not exactly right or not. But, you know, there's viewpoints that we have to absolutely reject as well, like I went over. And, you know, it says he is the firstborn in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 23. It says, to the general assembly and the church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect. I think the church of the firstborn is the church of Christ. I think Christ is the firstborn in that verse. But I could do another study and go over these more in detail. The firstborn, the first begotten. But if anybody tries to use those verses to teach that Christ didn't exist until he was begotten or till he was born on this earth as a man or whatever, you know, that's false. And we can see that by all these evidences that I'm about to give. So, now let's get into the really fun part. I had to get over that. And so, let's see here. We're going to go over the testimony of Jesus himself, the things that he said will prove that he was pre-existent, his own words, things the apostles said, things the prophets said, manifestations of Christ in the Old Testament, and things that imply that Christ was pre-existent. So I'm going to try to set these up in different categories. Let's see what we got here. Let's see. I'll just write some of the verses down as I go through them. So we got Jesus, the apostles, and then we got the prophets, and then we got the manifestation. I don't know if that's going to be all on the screen. I guess it is. And so I'll divide these. And then we got things by implication, which I'll go over too. Okay. So. Hopefully there will be enough room. Now, let's see. Evidence of the pre-existence of Christ, that he eternally pre-existed. The testimony of Jesus himself, John chapter 10, verse 30. Okay. John chapter 10, verse 30 says, I and my Father are one. And I probably went over this in the deity of Christ. But, you know, a lot of these are interchangeable for different doctrines. We'll be going over the same verses over and over and over again and look at different aspects, different things that are taught in them. Anyways, God and Christ are one in a much higher sense than Christ and believers are one, namely one in essence and nature, one in authority and power, Christ being co-substantial with God. Look at the context of the passage that this verse is in. And Christ says, you know, that basically you're secure in the Father's hand and you're secure in mine. He's saying, you know, I have the same power. We are one. We are equal in essence, in nature, and power, authority. We see then that one, that the Lord Jesus Christ is for nature co-essential, for dignity co-equal, and for duration co-eternal with the Father. Okay, if he and his Father are one in power, then they must be one in eternity as well. And also, although Christ be one in essence with the Father, yet they are distinct persons, one from another. Another important thing to know when we'll be going over more about the Trinity, they are distinct. Okay. That the Son, being one in essence, one in power, one in consent and will with the Father, they are both equally concerned for the perseverance of the saints, for preserving them in grace, and for bringing them to glory. None shall pluck them out of my Father's hand, for I and my Father are one. If the power be the same, the essence must be the same, and therefore the eternity must be the same. So it proves the deity of Christ, and also the eternity in the pre-existence of Christ. If he and his Father are one, he must have existed before the incarnation. So, you know, that's a little tiny verse that is so powerful when you look at the whole context of the thing. A big statement there. And so let's go to the next one. This one's probably one that people who have been saved for a while, reading Scripture for a while, know the basic doctrines. And I went over this in the deity of Christ as well, but this is one of the more obvious ones, but a good one. And that is John chapter 8, verse 58, which says, Jesus said unto them, Verily, 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 I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. So, you know, that's you know, just a staple for the pre-existence of Christ, you know. It's like, oh yeah, Christ didn't exist before the incarnation. Well, before Abraham was, I am. That's what he said. So, obviously, because Abraham's birth preceded Jesus' own birth by many centuries, how could he say this and it be possibly true? Okay, is Jesus a liar? Is he a crazy man? Because, you know, he said, before Abraham was, I am. What could he have meant by that? You know, and as I said before, that some try to take this idealist view that somehow Jesus, you know, Christ only pre-existed in the mind of God, in the foreknowledge, and they could try to say that that's what this means, but then we could say the same thing too. You know, we could say, well, I was in God's foreknowledge as well, so I guess before Abraham was, I am too. Now, obviously, that's not what Jesus meant, and that's not how the Jews took it either. Okay, before Abraham was, I am. The words rendered was and am are quite different. The one clause means, Abraham was brought into being. Before Abraham was, before he was brought into being. The other, I exist. The statement, therefore, is not that Christ came into existence before Abraham did, as Arians affirm this is the meaning, but that he never came into being at all, but existed before Abraham had a being. In other words, existed before creation, or eternally, as John chapter 1, verse 1, in the sense that the Jews plainly understood him, since they took up stones to cast at him, just as they had before done when they saw that he made himself equal with God, in John chapter 5, verse 18. Okay, so the Jews took it as he meant that, you know, that he was God, that he was equal with God. So a great verse to prove the pre-existence of Christ, before Abraham was, I am. And, you know, also Jesus said, I am, specifically just like, you know, when it was said to Moses in Exodus, you know, I am that I am. Proving Christ's deity, proving his pre-existence, proving that he is eternal, that he has no beginning. Now, let's go to John chapter 17, verse 5. John chapter 17, verse 5, which says, And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. Seems like Christ pre-existed the incarnation to me. Before the world was, there could not be a more distinct and clear declaration of the pre-existence of Christ than this. It means before the creation of the world, before there was any world. Of course, the speaker here must have existed then, and this is equivalent to saying that he existed from eternity. John chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, John chapter 6, verse 62, John chapter 3, verse 13, John chapter 16, verse 28, The glory which he had then was that which was proper to the Son of God, represented by the expression being in the bosom of the Father, John chapter 1, verse 18, denoting intimacy, friendship, united felicity. The Son of God, by becoming incarnate, is represented as humbling himself in Philippians chapter 2, verse 8. He laid aside, for a time, the eternal aspect of honor and consented to become despised and to assume the form of a servant. He now prays that God would raise him up to the dignity and honor which he had before his incarnation. This is the state to which he is now exalted, with the additional honor of having made atonement for sin and having opened the way to save a race of rebels from eternal death. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, God, for that. You know, the glory that he had with the Father before the world was. Obviously, Christ is preexistent. Obviously, Christ is divine. How else would you explain these passages? There's so many of them. You know, It's just crazy just to see people who deny the Trinity or the deity of Christ or, you know, his preexistence and how they try to explain this stuff. It's just a mess. Next up, John chapter 17, verse 24. So a little bit later. And you'll notice that so far all these have been in John. So John is a really good book to show the deity of Christ, that he is God, and obviously the preexistence as well. But of course, the deity and the preexistence of Christ is taught all throughout the Bible. But John is a very good gospel for that. And also, you know, it's good for eternal security, all kinds of stuff. The Gospel of John's awesome. You know, that's probably, you know, a gospel that maybe I would suggest that a lot of people who just got saved or haven't really read the Bible, maybe, you know, read first the Gospel of John. And it's pretty simple to read. But yeah, it's they're all awesome, you know. John chapter 17, verse 24, Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. The love of the Father to the Son before the foundation of the world implies the personal preexistence of the latter with God. Very simple. Next, John chapter 13, verse 3. There's no real order for these things, no real purpose the way I did these. They're kind of out of order and everything. Anyways, John chapter 13, verse 3, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he was come from God, and went to God. All things given into his hands means universal and absolute dominion. That he was come from God means preexistence, voluntary incarnation, an eternal divine nature, and unbroken communion with the Father. That he went to God means a voluntary departure from this low world and return to his own calm home, his habitation from eternity. Pretty simple. Then there's other verses that state that Jesus came from God or heaven, which imply his preexistence. And so those would be, let's see here. Okay, I'm not going to write these down, but you can remember these if you want. So these are other verses that pretty much say the same thing, that Jesus was come from God or come from heaven, which implies preexistence. John chapter 6, verse 38, for I came down from heaven, not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. John chapter 6, verse 51, I am the living bread, which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever, and the bread that I give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. John chapter 3, verse 13, and no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven, which is a very interesting verse too. It says the Son of Man, which is in heaven, like currently. Yes, Jesus is omnipresent. He's omnipotent, all-powerful, all-knowing. John chapter 6, verse 33, for the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. Preexistence. John chapter 8, verse 42, Jesus said unto them, if God were your Father, you would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. I already existed before the incarnation as the Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father. John chapter 16, verse 28 through 30, I came forth from the Father and am come into the world. Again, I leave the world and go to the Father. His disciples said unto him, lo, now speakest thou plainly and speakest no proverb. Now are we sure that thou knowest all things. Omniscience, thou knowest all things and needest not that any man should ask thee. By this we believe that thou camest forth from God, that thou truly art the Son of God, that thou art equal with God, that thou preexisted your human birth. So there's so many there, things that Jesus said, okay, things that Jesus knew, that taught his preexistence. Okay, so that's, you know, that's plenty right there. That's just enough, really, just to prove it. But, you know, there's going to be more. So, you know, but how great of evidence is that? The testimony of Jesus himself, you know, and then either we're faced with the fact that either he was telling the truth or he was crazy. And, you know, obviously he was telling the truth. He was God in the flesh. He's our Lord and Savior. It's by his blood that we're redeemed. Now let's look at the testimony of the apostles that will prove the preexistence of Christ. Let's look at the apostle John. Okay. Surprise, surprise, we're not leaving the Gospel of John yet, but shortly. Okay, so we got John chapter 1, verse 1 and 5. And if you've known the Bible for a while, you knew this was coming. And then verse 14, and I'm not going to go over this a whole lot because I'll probably cover this more and more in the deity of Christ and other things. And anyways, John chapter 1, verse 1 through 5 says, "In the beginning was the Word." Remember I said the identity in his existence before the incarnation as the eternal Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. And then we see later in John chapter 1, verse 14, "And the Word was made flesh, and he dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." The Word was made flesh. So Christ eternally existed as the Word, and then he took on a human nature. He assumed a human nature. Okay, he didn't become another person. He took on another nature. And so Christ is one divine person with two natures, a divine nature and a human nature. I went over that before, and I'm going to go over more on his divine nature, the fact that he is deity, and then hopefully then I'll go over the humanity, the human nature. A lot of these things are pretty plainly obvious from Scripture. You know, it's hard to say that something's obvious in Scripture when, you know, not everybody agrees. And some people, you know, we need to be taught. We need to study these things. But it's like, man, it's just so obvious that Christ was preexistent, that Christ was God in the flesh. So, in these verses, these passages, we have Christ's coexistence with God from eternity, his identity with God, his creatorship as God back in creative days. So, proves his preexistence, proves his divinity, he's divine, deity. So, next let's go to Paul. Some things that Paul said about Christ that showed that he was preexistent. So we go to Philippians. What am I doing here? Philippians chapter 2, verse 6. Usually I would abbreviate Philippians P-H-I-L, but I guess they, what is that, the sword, E-sword? I guess it does P-H-P, so maybe I'll try to start doing that. So it'll be a habit I'll have to change maybe, but. So I guess you can abbreviate Philippians P-H-P. It's good to know abbreviations, too, for the books in the Bible. Anyways, Philippians chapter 2, verse 6, "Who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God." The form here referred to must have been something before he became a man, or before he took upon him the form of a servant. It was something which he humbled himself by, making himself of no reputation, by taking upon himself the form of a servant, and by being made in the likeness of men. Of course, it must have been something which existed when he had not the likeness of people. That is, before he became incarnate. He must therefore have had an existence before he appeared on earth as a man. And in that previous state of existence, there must have been something which rendered it proper to say that he was in the form of God. Okay? He's a divine person in the Trinity, the second person, equal with the Father. He's deity of the same essence as the Father. So, Philippians chapter 2, verse 6, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, obviously. He was in the form of God before the incarnation. He was preexistent. And also, again, that proves his deity. Now, 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. God was manifest in the flesh. Not God essentially considered, okay, as the triune God or deity in the abstract, but personally, and not in the first or third person, for of neither of them could this or the following things be said, but the second person, the Word, the Son of God, see 1 John chapter 3, verse 8, who existed as a divine person and is a distinct one from the Father and Spirit before his incarnation, and which is a proof of his true and proper deity. The Son of God in his divine nature is equally invisible as the Father, but became manifest by the assumption of human nature in a corporeal way, so as to be seen, heard, and felt. And by flesh is not meant not that part of the body only which bears that name, nor the whole body only, but the whole human nature, consisting of a true body and a reasonable soul, so-called partly to denote the frailty of it, and to show that it was not a person, but a nature Christ assumed. And the clause is added, not so much to distinguish this manifestation of Christ from a spiritual manifestation of him to his people, as in distinction from all other manifestations of him in the Old Testament, in a human form or time, and in the cloud, both in the tabernacle and temple. So, wow, that's a lot. So, we can learn a lot from 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, that God was manifest in the flesh. What a powerful verse. You know, that he took on a nature, okay, that he preexisted as the eternal Word, as the Son of God, the God, God the Son, I guess you could say. So, that obviously proves preexistence. And we just keep coming up with these verses. So, I mean, does anybody want to deny the preexistence of Christ? Does anybody want to deny that Christ is God? Well, yeah, there are lots of them, unfortunately. And we can't really see how, but there are. So, it's deception. I mean, I guess we can see how, because of sin and, Satan, demons. So, Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 through 17. Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? For by him were all things created that are in heaven and are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. Now, he is before all things, as he must be, if he created all things. Those who regard this as referring to a moral creation interpret it as meaning that he has the preeminence over all things, not as referring to his preexistence. But the fair and proper meaning of the word before is that he was before all things in the order of existence. Compare Matthew chapter 8, verse 29, John chapter 11, verse 55, John chapter 13, verse 1, Acts chapter 5, verse 36, Acts chapter 21, verse 38, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 2. It is equivalent to saying that he was eternal. For he that had an existence before anything was created must be eternal. Thus, it is equivalent to the phrase, in the beginning, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, compare the notes, John 1, verse 1. I didn't need to add that part, but, you know, and I want to say, you know, all these commentaries that I got from Bible Hub. So I found all the verses that teach preexistence that I could. I went to a lot of studies online and listened to sermons, and I put together like this framework for all these verses and categorized them, and then, you know, I went to each individual verse on Bible Hub, and I tried to find like the best commentaries that explain these verses, or, you know, that refute false interpretations of these verses, and so that's how I did it. You know, Bible Hub's all public domain, and so there's nothing wrong with that, and it's a great resource. So anybody can put together these studies. You know, it's just, it takes time and dedication, and you know, some of it I've added myself, and you know, I've had to think of things. Sometimes I don't find satisfactory commentaries on things. I don't agree with any of them sometimes, but you know, this is pretty basic. You know, a lot of people, you know, even Catholics will teach the preexistence of Christ. And as I said, even some of the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Mormons, Seventh-day Adventists, they won't deny that Christ preexisted. They'll just, they'll deny aspects of it. So it's a pretty, you know, with all in professing Christianity, you know, a lot of people will accept the preexistence of Christ, but they might not accept his deity, and then that's, you know. Anyways, did I read this one? Oh, yeah, okay. So next we're going to go into the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2 and 3, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. He was the Son of God when the worlds were made by him. Okay. Because it says, hath in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom he made the worlds. He made the worlds by his Son. Okay? You know, Jesus created all things. So he was eternally the Son. So he is eternally begotten of the Father. There's that eternal generation of Christ, that eternal sonship. Accordingly, he without whom was not anything made that was made is called the only begotten of the Father. John chapter 1, verse 1 through 14, which we went over, basically. Therefore, the Son, as the Son, was before all worlds, and his glory reaches from everlasting to everlasting, though God spake by him to us only in these last days. Next, Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8. And this study was about 9 pages long when I printed it out. So I went over this in hardcore detail like in the last couple of weeks. And I've refined it and refined it and refined it. You know, I took like 3 commentaries or whatever. I'm like, okay, these are all good. And then, you know, they talk about the Greek or different things. And I'm like, oh, I don't want that. And so, you know, I just refined it, refined it, refined it. And it's like, you know, I want to get to the point. But anyways, yeah, about 9 pages. And, you know, the study's never going to be perfect, but sometimes it's worth taking the extra time. So, Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, the same yesterday and today and forever. These words may be expressive of the duration of Christ. He was yesterday, which does not assign the day immediately foregoing. Okay, it doesn't mean yesterday, literally. Today's Friday, so, you know, Thursday he was the same, but, you know, no. It means more than that. For some little time past, it doesn't mean simply that, but ancient times, formerly, of old, and though it does not extend to eternity, which is true of Christ, yet may be carried further than to the days of his flesh here on earth, even to the whole Old Testament dispensation, yea, to the beginning of the world, when he existed not only as the eternal Word, the everlasting I Am, but as the Savior and Redeemer of his people, during which dispensation he frequently appeared in human form, and was the sum of all promises and prophecies, the substance of all types and shadows, and the spiritual food of his people, and he is today under the gospel dispensation, in his person as God-man, and in his offices as prophet, priest, and king, and will be so ever, so forever. He will never die more. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his priesthood is an unchangeable one. Moreover, these words may regard the immutability of Christ, who is unchangeable in his person, perfections, and essence as God, and in his love to his people, and in the fullness of his grace, and in the efficacy of his blood, and in the virtue of his sacrifice and righteousness. So, when it says he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, the yesterday means of old, before he was born as the man Jesus. So it talks about his preexistence, and also it talks about his immutability, that he is the same back then as he was, as he is now, and always will be. And so only God is immutable in that sense, unchanging. And so if Christ is God, then he must be eternally preexistent. He must be eternal. Now, let's go to the testimony of the prophets. Testimony of the prophets. Now, I wanted to list a few verses just to show that when Jesus or the apostles said specifically in the Bible that the Old Testament prophets spoke of him. So, you know, in a way, these imply preexistence, but I'm not really using these verses to teach that necessarily. I just thought they would be cool to add this. When we're talking about the testimony of the prophets, of Christ being preexistent, John chapter 5, verse 39, Jesus said, "Search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, but they are they which testify of me." Talking about the Old Testament, it testifies of him. Luke chapter 24, verse 25 through 27, "Then he said unto them, O fools, and slow of heart, to believe all that the prophets have spoken." That's not very Christ-like, is it? I'm just kidding. Okay, that was Christ that said that, actually. So, and it's not, you know, a mistranslation, because I believe that the King James Bible is the inerrant word of God, right? But anyways, he said, "O fools, slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the Scriptures the things concerning himself." So from Moses on up, you know, and he could have even went to Genesis, but obviously Christ was spoken of in the Old Testament. In Acts chapter 10, verse 43, "To him gave all the prophets witness that through his name, whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins." So he was spoken of in the Old Testament, and now we're going to go over some of those specific instances, such as Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1 through 5. So we got Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1 through 5. Okay. All right. "Which says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne," the Lord sitting upon a throne, "high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then I said, Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." The one who Isaiah saw on the throne was Jesus, the Son of God. Because, John chapter 12, verse 39 through 41 says, "Therefore they could not believe, because that Isaiah said again, He hath blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, that they should not see with their eyes, nor understand with their heart, and be converted, and I should heal them. These things said Isaiah when he saw his glory and spake of him." When did he see his glory? Well, in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1 through 5, he saw the Lord sitting on the throne, the Lord Jesus Christ, the pre-existent Son of God, the eternal Son of God. Now, let's look at Micah chapter 5, verse 2. But thou, Bethlehem, Ephratah, I hope I pronounced it right, Bethlehem, Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from old, from everlasting. This is perhaps the most important single prophecy in the Old Testament. It respects the personal character of the Messiah and the discoveries of himself to the world. Here is foretold that Bethlehem should be his birthplace. Hence, it was universally known among the Jews in Matthew chapter 2, verse 5. It distinguishes his human birth from his existing from eternity. So, there will be a ruler who will come forth who has been from old, from everlasting. Christ spoken of by the Old Testament prophets, and the fact that he was pre-existent. Let's see here. Isaiah, again. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. I hope that this will keep recording. I noticed we went well over an hour, 8 minutes. So this is a good one, though. I love this study. This might be my favorite study I've ever done. And I hope that other people will appreciate this as well. And maybe I'm not very entertaining when I'm giving the study, but there's a lot of information here. And of course, you can go to the website, acceptyoubeconverted.com, kjvforum.com, kjvchat.com. You can find the study under Sound Doctrine, Jesus Christ. Look at his person and natures, and then you'll see the pre-existence. Anyways, Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and call his name Emmanuel. Now, we read in Matthew chapter 1, verse 22 and 23, now all this was done that might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. And they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is by interpretation God with us. Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, once it appears that the Messiah is truly God, as well as truly man. The name is expressive of the union of the two natures, human and divine, in him, of his office as mediator, who being both God and man is a middle person between both, of his converse with men on earth, and of his spiritual presence with his people. See John chapter 1, verse 14. So, again, we see that, you know, Jesus was God in the flesh, and therefore he must have pre-existed. Now, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 and 7. I mean, I think that pretty much any time that Christ is spoken of in the Old Testament kind of implies pre-existence. So, you know, there could be all kinds of more verses to teach us. I'm just trying to give some of the best ones, some of the more specific ones. But, you know, there could be many. There's many verses that would imply his pre-existence. Anyways, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 and 7, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth ever or even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. We have here the great mystery of the incarnation. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Unto us a child is born relates, we may safely say, to the humanity of Christ. To us a son is given relates to the divine nature of Christ. He was a son when born, even the eternal Son of God. Another verse that we could use to teach the eternal sonship of Christ. and the eternal generation. The phrase, the mighty God, this is one, but one out of the many of the instances in which the name God is applied to Messiah. Compare John chapter 1, verse 1, Romans chapter 9, verse 5, 1 John chapter 5, verse 20, John chapter 20, verse 28, 1 Timothy chapter 3, 16, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8. The name mighty God is unquestionably attributed to the true God in Isaiah chapter 10, verse 21. And so his deity implies his preexistence. The fact that a son is given implies, you know, that he eternally preexisted as the Son of God. The Everlasting Father, I thought this would be interesting to know, because it's said that he's the Everlasting Father. This does not design any relation to Christ and the Godhead. And there is but one Father in the Godhead, and that is the first person. Indeed, Christ and the Father are one, and the Father is in him, and he is in the Father, and he that has seen the one has seen the other, and yet they are distinct. Christ is not the Father. It is easy to make it appear Christ is not the Father, but distinct from him, since he is said to be with the Father from eternity, to be the Son of the Father in truth and love, his own Son, his only begotten and beloved Son. Christ frequently calls the first person his Father, prayed to him as such, and is our advocate with him, as well as the way unto him. He is said to be sent by the Father to come from him and to go to him. And many things are said of Christ that cannot be said of the Father, as his being made flesh, suffering and dying in the room of his people. And the Father is said to do many things unto him, as to anoint him, to seal him, to show him all he did, to commit all judgment to him, and give him, and to give him to have life in himself as he did. But Christ is a Father with respect to... Okay, I took that part out, I guess. Anyways, I guess I didn't finish that one. I should have looked over a little more, but... When it says the Eternal Father, I think it's saying that he's, you know, like the Father of the Covenant, basically. Because after it says he's the Eternal Father, it says he is the Prince of Peace. And so Prince implies, you know, a son. You know, a prince is like the son of a king. So when it says the Eternal Father, it's not mixing up, you know, it's not saying he's the Father, you know, the person in the Godhead. Okay, it's a title that means something different. And I went through all that to show you that there are distinctions between the Son and the Father. And so that, you know, that's hard for non-Trinitarians to explain, you know. So the Father sent the Son, the Father anointed him, the Father sealed him. Okay, did the Father send himself? When Jesus prayed to the Father, did he pray to himself? Okay, so that's the kind of absurdity that they have to try to explain. And, you know, it just doesn't work. So there are obvious distinctions. Those distinctions always have been, there's always been those distinctions between the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. But anyways, you know, the mighty God, this all implies deity. It implies and teaches his preexistence. Then let's look at John the Baptist, who was a prophet. John chapter 1. Oh, we're back in John again. Surprise, surprise. I can't leave that up. John chapter 1, verse 30. This is an interesting one, too. John chapter 1, verse 30. John the Baptist said, "This is he of whom I said, after me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me." What? Because from Luke chapter 1, verse 26, we find out that naturally speaking, John the Baptist was 6 months older than Jesus. He could have only referenced to Christ's pre-existence. So, that's an interesting one. Anyways, let's look at the manifestations of Christ in the Old Testament. I made some videos about this a long time ago when I first found out about it. I thought it was pretty cool. I guess they're called, like, theosophies. They can be called Christophyses. But I've also read that, you know, when Christ appeared in the Old Testament in a human form, then those are called theosophies. And then when Christ appeared after the resurrection to people like Paul and John, Revelation, then those are called Christophanies, but I don't know. Either way, Christ was seen in the Old Testament, okay? He was manifested in a human form. He wasn't incarnate like when he became incarnate, became the man Jesus. But anyways, I'm only going to go over a couple of these. There's a whole bunch of these in the Old Testament that could definitely be its own study, and it needs to be a future study on its own. So I'm just going to go over a couple really quick. So we got Joshua chapter 5, verse 13 through 15. Please, God, let the microphone still be recording, because I've had that happen to me before, and we're well over an hour, and I've had to do stuff like that before. Can you imagine having to redo everything that I just did and just erase this board and be like, okay, let's start over. You know, it just makes me want to do it like I'll just do it tomorrow or whatever and then like never get to it. It's just, but praise God, I'm pretty sure that we're still rolling, I hope. Or maybe some people will just be really good lip readers, and I could just post it anyways. Joshua chapter 5, verse 13 through 15, and it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho, that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, art thou for us or for our adversaries? And he said, nay, but as the captain of the host of the Lord am I now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship and said unto him, what saith my Lord unto his servant? And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place whereon thou standest is holy. And Joshua did so. There appeared to him one as a man to be noticed. This man was the Son of God, the eternal Word. Joshua gave him divine honors and received him, which a created angel would not have done, and he is called Jehovah in chapter 6, verse 2. So, Jesus appeared to Joshua in the Old Testament in a human form, okay? And let's look at Exodus chapter 3, verse 2. So, we got here Exodus chapter 3, verse 2, which says, and the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush was burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. The angel of the Lord appeared unto him, not a created angel, but the angel of the covenant, Christ, who then was and ever was God, and was to be man, and a messenger from God to man. He termed the angel of God's presence in Isaiah chapter 63, verse 9, had wrestled with Jacob in Genesis chapter 32, verse 24, and had redeemed him from all evil in Genesis chapter 48, verse 16, and afterward conducted his posterity through the wilderness, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. These, his temporary appearances, were passages of his more solemn mission and coming, or presages, not passages, on account of which he is fitly called the angel or messenger, that this angel was no creature, appears from his saying, I am the Lord, a language which angels never speak, but I am sent from God. It is a vain pretense to say that the angel, as God's ambassador, speaks in God's name and person. For what ambassador of any king in the world did ever speak thus, I am the king? Ministers are God's ambassadors, but if any of them should say, I am the Lord, they would be guilty of blasphemy. And so would any created angel be too, for the same reason. I love that. I had to add that in there. Where it's like, you know, what messenger sent from the king would be like, I am the king. You know, obviously that would not be right. So, and it wouldn't be right for us to say, you know, as messengers of God, you know, spreading the gospel, going around saying, I am God. Even though, you know, there is that word of faith movement where they say we are little gods or whatever, and they basically, you know, do blasphemy. And anyways, that's just... So obviously, you know, this angel was the Lord himself. He said that. And so that's what it was. It was a manifestation of Christ in the Old Testament, which proves his preexistence. And, you know, that's where they could say, you know, the Jehovah's Witnesses, they might look at that and say, well, see, Christ preexisted as an angel, the angel of the Lord. He was created or whatever. But then we'll say, no, he said that he was the Lord. You know, and where you stand is on holy ground. And Joshua worshipped him. Okay, and he didn't rebuke Joshua. So obviously there's more to it than that. And, you know, he eternally preexisted. Now we can look at implication. Where I'm going to just go over things really fast, because all this stuff could be looked at in more detail, but you know, there's just so much that proves the preexistence of Christ. So the testimony of implication. So these things that I'm going to talk about imply that Christ preexisted. The works of creation are ascribed to Christ. Okay. So, you know, Christ created everything. I don't know how much that's on there, but let's see. It doesn't matter, but I'll try to get it on there. It's just getting kind of messy now. Trying to say it in a simple way where I can fit it on here, but Christ created everything. The works of creation are ascribed to him. John chapter 1, verse 3, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, for by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 10, and thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thine hands. Okay, and there's plenty of other verses that could show that Christ is the creator of everything. And so, therefore, if he created everything, he must be before everything. And you know, that's something that only God can do. So he's divine, he's preexistent. Many titles of deity are ascribed to Christ that relate him to Jehovah of the Old Testament, therefore eternally existing. Okay? Titles of deity. So this also proves the deity of Christ, so I can go over these in more detail in another study. But titles of deity. You know, the Son of God, the first and the last, the Alpha and Omega, the Lord of all, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, God with us. See how Jesus himself uses this to affirm his deity and answer the question of his sonship in Matthew chapter 22, verse 42 through 45, saying, what think ye of Christ? Whose son is he? They say unto him, the son of David. He hath said unto them, how then doth David in spirit call him Lord, saying, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at on my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool. If David then call him Lord, how is he his son? Okay, so he is the Son of God by nature. The Son of God, the title, the Son of God, you know, proves his deity. That's who he is in relation to the Father. In a way that we can't understand. Really, you know, how is Christ eternally the Son and the Father eternally the Father? Can't understand that. That blows our minds just to think about that. But we can't wait to meet the Lord, right? To be with him. Also, the triune usage of names. Matthew 28, chapter 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Okay, there are lots of other names, you know, that show that Christ is deity, you know, used with the name of the Father and the Holy Ghost like that. It shows that, and therefore he must pre-exist, must exist eternally, must have no beginning. He's explicitly called God. John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Titus chapter 2, verse 13, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8, but unto the Son he saith, thy throne, O God. Unto the Son he saith, thy throne, O God. Unto the Son he saith, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Okay? explicitly called God, therefore implying that he was pre-existent eternally. His pre-existence is implied by the fact that he is worshipped as God. Okay? So, worshipped as God. And I guess that I could put, you know, he was called God. But, you know, I kind of thought that kind of goes with the titles of deity, but we'll just put that in its own separate category. Okay, but he's worshipped as God. Where was I at? Oh, John chapter 20, verse 28, and Thomas answered and said to him, My Lord and my God. In Hebrews chapter 1, verse 6, and again, when he bringeth in the first begotten into the world, he saith, And let all the angels of God worship him. The attributes of deity are ascribed to him. That implies his preexistence. Okay? So, divine attributes. Divine attributes. There are so many of these, and I want to go over the attributes of God individually. So amazing to study these things. But, you know, one is life. John chapter 1, verse 4, In him was life, and the life was the light of men. In him was life. God is life. Jesus is life itself, okay? Life comes forth from him. And so, therefore, that's something that can only be said of God. And, therefore, you know, Christ must have pre-existed. Self-existence. John chapter 5, verse 26, For as the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself. Self-existent. Only God can be self-existent, therefore he must have pre-existed eternally. Immutability. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, Jesus Christ the same yesterday and today and forever. And I already mentioned that implies his pre-existence. In one way, because the same yesterday means from old, from before he was born. And it means that he's immutable and unchanging, which only God can be, and so therefore he's pre-existent. Omnipresence, Matthew chapter 28, verse 20, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Only God can say that truly, so Christ must be, therefore, pre-existent before the incarnation. Omniscience, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5, Therefore judge nothing before the time until the Lord come, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the hearts, and then shall every man have praise of God. So he knows all things. Only God can know all things in that sense. He and the Father are one. He is eternal. And omnipotence, Matthew chapter 28, verse 18, And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in earth, in heaven and in earth. All-powerful, only such as God can be, must be pre-existent, must be eternal. That's it. That's all I got today. So that's well over an hour and a half, I guess. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so glad that I got this study done. And actually, I guess I'll just go ahead and say a prayer. Thank you, God, for this wonderful day and for the people watching this video. I pray that you will just lay this on their hearts if they haven't been saved, that they will turn to you, God, and realize that your word is true. Your Son is eternal, and that you gave your Son to die for our sins, Lord. And we thank you and praise you so much for that. And thank you. I pray that you'll help me and others who watch this to study and learn. And pray that you'll bless us all with good health, Lord, and our families. We all have our individual struggles, God, and help us to rely on your strength in all things, God. How often do we forget to rely on you, and that is what we need to do, God. And we just thank you for being there for us, being there for us always, and what a mighty, awesome God you are. We praise you and give you the highest praise and honor that you deserve, Lord, and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So, sorry it took me a while to get to this study, but I think it was worth the time. I actually have been working on this for like the last couple of weeks, but I mean, I've had the study, basically the frame of it, for a long time, but I've really went into detail the last couple of weeks to really get this out. And it's because I really want to work on these basic sound doctrines. I want to go more into the attributes of God and the Trinity, and more into, you know, the divine nature of Christ, the human nature of Christ, more into the Holy Spirit, and So all that stuff needs to be gone over, and hopefully over time I'll be going through these things faster and faster. Some of them are pretty basic, and we all know a lot of it. And I try to go into more details than what most people do. Actually, the pre-existence of Christ, like if you get on Sermon Audio and specifically look up the pre-existence of Christ, when I did a while ago, I came up with like 20 sermons specifically, okay? But if, you know, they talk about the deity of Christ, you know, there's like over 500 videos and or sermons, and I'm sure that, you know, a lot of them cover the pre-existence. But I'm just saying, if you look up specifically the pre-existence of Christ, there isn't a whole lot. And, you know, a lot of these studies go over just the basics, you know, before Abraham was, I am, you know, in the beginning was the Word. And that's fine, you know, that's good. But I try to go beyond, above and beyond a little bit with some of these studies. So hopefully today I did that. Hopefully you learned something that you haven't known before. I didn't know about the eternal generation of Christ, that he has always begotten. I didn't know that's what that doctrine was called. And, you know, that there were people who taught that he pre-existed, but he didn't pre-exist as the Son of God. I didn't know that. I didn't really know a lot about the specific details into this and how deep it is and how it's all connected. And so the doctrine of the pre-existence of Christ is a really very important doctrine. And a lot of things stand on this. So anyways, hope you learned something. And please leave comments. Please visit the website. You can come and chat with me, kjvchat.com. And, you know, I'm always up to studying the Bible. I'm always up to trying to find answers to questions. I have questions all the time. So thank you for watching. Please subscribe if you haven't. Please share with others. And hopefully over time in the summer I'll be making more and better videos and just growing in the Lord. And I want you to grow with me. So thank you for watching. God bless.